So I am a neuropsychologist, which means I'm a clinical psychologist with specialized expertise in the brain. And when I think about my work, I really think about my work in sort of three pillars. So I think about your brain, your leadership, and I think about your emotional intelligence.
Dr. Julia, welcome to the Leadership Jam session.
So glad to be here. Thank you so much for having me, Rob. I'm excited for the conversation.
I'm excited as well. So are you ready to jam?
I am ready to jam.
All right. So I am excited about this topic because this is a hot topic out there with emotional intelligence and leadership. It's been a hot topic for many years. So I'd love to get your thoughts and perspective on how leadership relates to emotional intelligence.
I am thrilled to be talking about this. I have so much to say, so you can certainly slow my roll. So I am a neuropsychologist, which means I'm a clinical psychologist with specialized expertise in the brain. And when I think about my work, I really think about my work in sort of three pillars. So I think about your brain, I think about your leadership, and I think about your emotional intelligence. Now, obviously, like in our careers, our thinking about our work evolves. And there's so much stuff these days about leadership in uncertain times, right? Yeah. So it's uncertain. It's uncertain. It's still uncertain. What are we going to do about all this uncertainty? My thinking has evolved so much that I'm going to say something pretty bold. I actually think that leadership and emotional intelligence are synonyms.
Okay.
So what I mean by this is the human brain hates uncertainty. In fact, to make this really clear, one thing I always say is there's only one emotion that all people universally hate. So I certainly work with people who are very comfortable being angry. Anger can feel like a very powerful emotion. You know, you hear a lot about like artists or people who love that feeling of melancholy and nostalgia, right? Yeah. So there's a range in terms of how people feel about their feelings. But universally, people hate being confused. And the reason people hate being confused is the brain is most fundamentally a pattern detection machine. Okay, so your brain likes to go apple, 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 banana, banana, banana. This is going to work out. This is going to work out. This is going to work out. These people like me. These people like me. These people like me. These people don't like me. These people don't like me. These people don't like me. And if you think about it from a survival, not a thriving perspective, but a surviving perspective, it's very adaptive, right? So the problem with uncertainty, the problem with confusion, is that your pattern detector does not know how to close the pattern. It doesn't know how to close the proverbial loop. So this is why uncertainty drives everyone crazy. I'll tell you really quickly about an experiment that, you know, lots of scientists, including in my own lab, people used to run, is you would put people in a room with an electrical shock machine. And I've had this shock administered to me, and it's absolutely painful. And you'd have two conditions. You'd have one condition where the machine would count down 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and you absolutely would get a shock. And you'd have another condition where the machine would count down 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and you may or may not get a shock. In other words, the condition was uncertain. And statistically, people prefer to be in the condition where they are certain they are going to receive physical pain. Now, I think there's plenty of like economists that, you know, and other people who would call this behavior irrational. I don't think it's irrational at all. I think the brain is communicating something wholly to us, which is our experiences of uncertainty are literally painful, and under certain circumstances, emotional pain is more painful than physical pain. So when we think about leadership in uncertain times, what that really means is so many of our contextual cues have gone away. So we're not doing client meetings. We're not having coffees. We're not flying across the country. I mean, on the most extreme, like we don't even really understand what's going on in our national political system and our global world order. Okay. It's like, what the heck is happening?
Right.
So when all of these contextual cues go away, never is leadership more important, because now people can't look at their flight schedule and their coffee dates and our democratic voting processes. So they have their eyes on you as a leader, like they are locked in. So the reason I think leadership and emotional intelligence are synonyms, and I get chills every time I say it, is the measure of my leadership, the measure of my emotional power becomes who I am in my own moments of uncertainty, who I become in the void. Who do I become when I don't know what's going to happen? Who do I become when they're not doing it my way? Who do I become when I don't like the words coming out of your mouth?
Yeah.
That is the measure of my leadership.
You know what? I think that makes a lot of sense. Kind of goes back to the old adage of, you know, anybody could lead in good times. Right? It's the true test of leadership when things are going south. And how do you as a leader rise to the occasion, which is hard as a leader, because as you said before, we're humans too, going through that. And how do we rise to it? And because it does impact our employees.
Absolutely impacts our employees. And I could not agree more that I think we do ourselves a disservice sometimes when we use words like it's challenging or it's hard. I think if you really take this to the neurologic level, and we have plenty of like fMRI studies to back stuff like this up, the pain circuits in the brain are getting activated, right? The brain does not like uncertainty. So we, as leaders, it's not just hard for us. I would actually ratchet up the linguistics here and say it's painful.
Mm.
And I really think we need to think about, you know, the analog to physical health is so clear, right? No one ever wonders, like, the way I'm going to get stronger is absolutely never show up at the gym. I got a great plan. I'm just going to avoid physical fitness at all costs. It's going to be amazing. But why then is the link not as clear when it comes to our emotional power? And the reason I was so thrilled to do this podcast with you is I really, really, really in my bones believe that this is the conversation that changes the world. Emotions, if you really think about it, if you think, you know, the brain is at the helm of our entire consciousness. Emotions are the native language of our life. Mm. We come out of the womb. It was Mother's Day yesterday. We come out of the womb of our mother speaking only a language of emotion. And if we're really honest about it, we are speaking a language of painful emotion. Like, I don't know if you have kids yet, but do you have kids?
I have twin boys who are 19 going on 3. So yes.
Okay. Well, I have little ones. And when they came out, like, they weren't like, this is amazing. I feel so relaxed. It's very pleasant to be here. They were red-faced, shrieking, and terrified. And so isn't it so fascinating that we then spend our whole life trying to avoid, amputate, suffocate negative emotion? Like, we wouldn't. The function of the brain is to process pain. It's one of the core functions, right? It's very much about survival and safety. We would never ask the lungs not to breathe or the heart not to beat. And so I think there's such power in this conversation about how do we come back home to the emotional truth of our life?
Mm-hmm. So what I'm hearing you say is it's, you know, from your perspective, emotional intelligence, and correct me if I'm wrong, starts with our own emotions.
100%.
Okay.
And if you think about this, like, let me give you another analogy and tell me if this lands, because I really want to make sure this is clear for people.
Yeah.
You cannot give what you do not have.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot recognize what you do not know. So if I came to you and I was like, hey, Rob, I really, really need you to lend me like $50. I'm super in a pinch. Mm-hmm. And you genuinely wanted to help me, but you really did not have the $50. Like, you didn't know how to access it. You didn't know where it was. You didn't, no matter how much you want to, you cannot give me the $50. there's all these glorious conversations right now about leaders meeting the emotional life of their employees, right? So that's why you're having all these conversations about empathy, inclusion, resilience, emotional agility, authenticity, vulnerability, and go on and on and on and on, right? But how could I really meet people in that energy if I don't know it? I can't sing a song. I don't know.
Very true.
I can't talk in a language that I don't speak. It's like we've made mental health and we've made emotional intelligence so much more complicated than it needs to be. Like nobody runs around being like, hey, Rob, what's going to happen if I drop this ball? Like, do you think like gravity's going to pull it down? Or like, do you think maybe if I like look the other way, gravity wouldn't? It's like, it's so obvious.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm so glad you said that, because I do think oftentimes, particularly in leadership, we make things much more complicated than what they need to be. And emotional intelligence is like one of those big, broad buckets that people love to throw around, but may not necessarily understand what it truly means or how to simplify it to some extent. Mm-hmm. Right. And what I'm hearing you saying, it's yes, you know, there'll be a lot of people tie in empathy with emotional intelligence, but it first starts with understanding yourself and how you might react or how you behave in times of uncertainty, or I think I heard you say before, even, you know, during emotional pain too, some of the pain points.
Absolutely. And let me try to, and tell me if this is not clear, but when I use the term emotional pain, it's a provocative word, right? You know, I think it almost makes you want to kind of recoil. So part of the reason that the main reason that I use it is if you think about the brain, I always say it's the most precious real estate on the planet. And it's like less than 3 pounds it's tiny. So the circuits that give rise to any bad feelings in your life, any bad feelings. So you're stressed out because they got your coffee order wrong at Starbucks. You're sitting in traffic. You're furious at your spouse. You're fearful about your kids. You're enraged. You're terrified. You're anxious. Those sensations, like, it's interesting. We have a lot of words to describe like different shading, right? But the circuits in the brain that give rise to bad feelings are the circuits in the brain that give rise to bad feelings. It's not like you have a 500-pound brain and that part deals with anxiety and that part deals with stress. So when I talk about emotional pain, I'm talking about any time it feels bad in your body. So what that means is like another word that I think can help people really access this is you want to be a stronger leader. Figure out how to work with your triggers until you ain't triggered anymore. I really think there's this idea of being triggered to brilliance, being triggered to power. So here, let's just take an easy example. Say I have tons of, I got a lot of great ideas. Like, and I really feel called to express my ideas, but I can't public speak. I cannot get on a stage. God, I cannot like do a Facebook Live. I can't like stream a YouTube, but I really believe that I have all these great ideas. Well, my power is going to be hamstrung. And by power, I literally mean, so the definition of power is just my ability to have an effect. So my ability to express, my ability to get my message out, my ability to connect to people is hamstrung because my pain, i.e. my anxiety, my uncertainty, my fear of getting on stage is blocking my power. Well, what we know about the brain, and this is so powerful, because what happens when people are afraid is your brain wants you to avoid the thing. Your brain wants you to avoid the thing, the very thing that will set you free. We have a copious amount of neuroscientific evidence that says if you want to overcome your anxiety, repeatedly do the thing you are afraid of doing. You're afraid of public speaking. Get out there, get out there, get out there, get out there. And this is what I mean about triggered to freedom, triggered to brilliance. Like, is it going to suck at first? Abso-freaking-lutely. But the other thing that's really interesting to me is like, tell me if this lands for you. When I go to the gym and let's say I can only pick up a 10-pound weight, and I want to get stronger. So the next day I pick up a 20 pound weight or a 15 pound weight. You know how like your like bicep will start to shake?
Yep.
No one's ever like, oh my God, this is a disaster.
Yeah.
Can someone please call 911. I need someone to drive me to the hospital because my muscle is shaking right now.
Mm-hmm.
We're like that. The shake is the very evidence of my increasing strength. Why is it then when I go to public speak or I go to have a tough conversation or I go to express myself differently in some capacity in my life and I call it the emotional shake? The emotional shake shows up. I start to wobble. My energy truly starts to wobble. Sometimes I lose my voice. Yeah. I feel shaky. My hands start sweating. We interpret that evidence as evidence of imminent doom. Immediately shut down the effort and mm-hmm. go back to avoiding the emotional shake. Well, I know on a physical health level, I can't get stronger without it.
Yeah.
So if we could have people understand, like, I have to meet my pain differently. I have to meet my triggers differently. I have to meet my struggle differently. This is how we set the whole world free.
So the example you just said, there was, I'm going to go back to it. And I think this is going to help even cement, you know, this concept of what you're talking about from a leadership perspective. And I work with a lot of emerging leaders, individuals who want to become, you know, managers of people or who are new to managing. The biggest hurdle that, you know, this group has to overcome is giving feedback. And I think
you say giving or getting?
Giving feedback, having the tough conversation, as you just mentioned. And I think that exactly relates to what you're talking about, right? It's hard to do. And a lot of individuals really do struggle and avoid giving tough feedback in many cases. So I think that emotional shake, that you talked about, I think that applies. That's a great example of that. And over the years, yeah, I mean, look, first of all, if you don't have any issue giving tough feedback, you probably shouldn't be managing in the first place. That's a whole separate story, but I've often coached I often coached individuals on that. Over time is how you build the confidence to do. And that's exactly what you're saying, right? You have to do it over and over in order to overcome it, even though it is a pain point.
100%.
Yeah.
And I love what you're saying because I think it really kind of flips the goal on its head. So in a way, it's like, so one of the things I talk a lot about is I believe in human intuition for sure. I'm a yoga instructor. I think, you know, to have survived as long as humans have survived on the planet, like there is an intuition that is very strong. But one of the things that neuroscientific evidence is incredibly clear about is that to overcome our experience of emotional pain, our anxiety, our fear, our stress, et cetera, we have to do the counterintuitive. So you can think of your brain as like driving down like the highway of your life. And every time, and it recognizes this highway, but the problem is the highway is like, it just goes in a circle. And after like the fifth billionth time that you've gone around this highway, you're like, okay, like I was built for more. I need to get off this highway. I know everything here. And honestly, it's like not that satisfying. It's a little bit depressing. I'm a little bit bored. I'm a little bit uninspired. Let's go on a new road. But the pattern detection function of your brain is glorious. I mean, it's, again, I get chills every time I talk about it. But so it's amazingly adaptive. But if I want to do it different, the pull of the pattern is so strong that when I start to go on a new road, I'm going to hit the emotional rumple strip. This is another analog for the emotional shake. And my brain's going to go,
right. Yeah.
Now, unless I kind of am trumping the, you know, people love to talk about like the lizard brain or the reptilian mm-hmm. brain or that, like, reptile. And I think, yeah, these conversations are part of the way that people do this. When I hit the emotional shake, when I hit the emotional rumple strip, unless I had a conversation like you and I are having, or I'm working with someone, a coach or a mentor or a psychologist or whatever, I'm going to go back on the highway because my brain's that sensation is going to feel like danger. But I can train myself to make that same sensation, that zing, zing, zap, zap, zoink, zoink of your neurons firing be expansive. I can train myself to see that as me maximizing my potential. I can see, I can train myself to feel that feeling like freedom, hope, strength, but I have to be willing to go through the shake.
Yeah.
I have to be willing to like persist through the rumple strip.
Yeah. I love what you said before. I mean, this, everything we're talking about is, you know, using, I forget exactly how you started it up, but using your emotional pain in some ways to kind of set you free.
100%.
Well, I think we're going to have you back. This is a perfect setup. We're just going to have you back when the book gets released so you can talk about it. Cause I think that's a great topic as well.
I really appreciate that. I would be delighted to come back.
Well, thanks again for coming on, and we'll put your contact information in the show notes. That way, if anybody wants to reach out to you and research some of your information, we will make sure we post that.
Yep. And I'm on all the social media channels, so you can just find me there. It's the easy way to connect.
Great. Thanks again. Appreciate you coming on.
Thank you.